John. It's very nice to see everyone, and I'd like to offer my personal welcome. It's a pleasure to have you all here. This brief report of work in progress concerns the collection of holograms that the MIT Museum holds and an effort to make it accessible. And these are early stages, but we wanted to tell you about some angles of approach that we're working on and to show you a bit of progress. Now, as I'm sure most of you know, the museum has the world's most historically significant and comprehensive collection of display holograms. Now, this all sits in storage, or not quite all. We have a gallery, as you've noticed upstairs. However, the great majority of the holograms are in boxes, and you know, it's cumbersome, right? It takes lighting and setup and physical infrastructure to display these. We don't have a lot of physical space at the museum, which is another significant limiting factor. And of course, with the advent of digital technologies kind of flooding into the holography domain, it's a natural thought to bring analog holograms into digital form because of the accessibility, the flexibility, possibilities that would open up with regard to our collection. And so we have a few different angles of approach in mind. This work began with a concept of making our holograms accessible online in real time. And we wanted to begin with the selection of a single hologram and to build a robotic arm that would allow a real-time look around the three-dimensional space of the hologram by, you know, a web user at some distance. And that's a project that we are actively working on. Yet we jumped to another approach that is really coupled with the first, and that is digital capture. How can we bring the analog holographic information into digital form, into a data model, and then further, what could we do with that? Obviously, a first application is online exhibition. We have used the readily accessible Photosynth software to make an approach to this, and along the way we have found out about other software opportunities that are more refined for this kind of application, and we will show you some of that capturing that we've done. And in that work, we have worked in consultation with Noah Snavely of Cornell University, who is one of the developers of the Photosynth software, and that's been quite helpful. But there again, it's in early stages, and he has access to other software that is more specific to our task. I mentioned online exhibition. This is an obvious and I think for the museum a powerful direction to move in because of the support structure of technologies that that we are afforded nowadays, one can imagine slowly getting the rich collection that the museum holds online and the flexibility that would be involved with being able to show these holograms in digital form online and being able to compose exhibitions, being able to interpret and assemble holograms in relationship in the context of a kind of, so to speak, an online gallery or a virtual gallery. Now, we all know that we're speaking of viewing holograms in 2D and not 3D. This is a severe limitation, but what we are trying to do here is to approach the 3D experience through the 2D medium of online viewing. And so this is a basic limitation to everything that we're talking about here today. However, we are, that was some of the impetus behind the real-time robotic arm viewing of a hologram, is that we're trying to put distant visitors into a kind of visceral relationship with the holographic space, and that even though they're looking at it and seeing a 2D image, they are getting a kind of palpable feel for the 3D space because they are driving it, and because it is a real-time connection, and we could exploit that in different ways for people to feel the linkage with the 3D virtual space of the hologram. And then lastly, I would mention, of course, once we would have a data model of an analog hologram, then we could do other things with the holographic object, for example. One example would be rapid prototyping or a 3D print of an object that comes from an analog hologram. And one could think of many other possibilities. But in general, this whole approach of the museum is an obvious one, but I think increasingly it's a powerful one with regard to the communication of holography. The history that's incorporated in this collection, the different disciplines that are represented, the virtualities that can become physicalities by 3D printing, for example, and in general, the communication process and the visual expression and learning process that can take place via the web. This all makes up the terrain that we're exploring. And so, Alan, you perhaps could show us some examples. I would mention that many of you will know this hologram, but this is the Lindau Man, 1987 hologram of a 1984 find in a peat bog. This is by Richmond Holographic Studios in the UK.
Let's see. I'm going to move this around here so that I can see while I use the computer. This hologram, by the way, is hanging upstairs in the gallery, so you can go take a look at it. I'm being signaled from the back that you can't hear me, so I'll try to drive and talk into the microphone and do everything at the same time. So our work here. Let's see. Where's my keyboard? Okay. So. There's a bit of inspiration behind what we're doing here. At one point, I noticed that there were people, visitors to the museum, who were taking, excuse me, possibly surreptitious movies of our holograms with their cell phones and posting them on YouTube. And so when I discovered this, let's see if we can get this to play. Yeah, it kind of set off a light bulb, and the light bulb is that even though you have two dimensions, you can really evoke the third dimension by adding motion and time, essentially. So if you see any one of these frames, they look two dimensional, but if you look at the frames in series, you get a bit more of a three dimensional feel for this thing. So I thought, well, gee, that's cool. What if we could do this under controlled circumstances with something that's possibly a little more smooth than the human arm moving around, which is when I came up with the idea of doing a robotic arm. Unfortunately, we haven't gotten very far with the robotic arm yet, but we're actually gearing up to it. And so if anybody wants to help build a robotic platform that we can control through the web, let me know later on. So there's that, and this sort of experimentation took a little bit of a detour when the next light bulb hit, which is there's this technology called Photosynth, which has been developed by Microsoft or developed, I guess, at the University of Washington, largely by Noah Snavely, and there are other people working in this field, and the basic idea is that you can take multiple photographs of an object from different angles, and reconstruct digitally the three dimensionality of what you're taking the photographs of. And they don't even have to be from the same camera. They don't have to be from the same person. And if you go to photosynth.net, And you need to do this using Windows, or you can download a plugin for your Mac. You can see a lot of photosynths of tourist attractions, so cathedrals or the Eiffel Tower or things like that. But it turns out that if you take a bunch of photographs of a hologram, you can start to get the same effect. So we've done sort of four separate trials of this Lindau Man hologram. And I guess I should back up a little bit here. Let's see if I can. Okay. So essentially what you do is you take a bunch of photographs which let you start to move around in the image by clicking on the image, and each photograph, whenever you're sort of in its space, it comes up. And the way this works is that the software has constructed this digital model and has overlaid the photographs in a way that you can really see them. But what you can also do is you can look at what's called the point cloud, and there's a very slow reaction. It's almost like talking to the moon here. I'm not sure what's going on. So you can look at what's called the point cloud, and these are the points that it has constructed in order to find the 3D aspects of this thing. And those points, in fact, let you sort of examine this thing from more of a three-dimensional perspective. So you can start doing things like moving it around, and you can actually see some of the details. I'm having a little trouble driving on this surface too. Some of the details, some of the three-dimensionality come out. Now, of course, one thing you can't do with a hologram is you can't look behind it, at least not this one. There are others that are really sort of cylindrical, or I don't know if they are spherical ones. But the basic idea is it strikes me that there's enough 3D information coming out of these photographs that we could actually build a 3D model. And so in a conversation we had with Noah, he indicated that he has software that's kind of gone beyond what's available at Photosynth. He's at Cornell University right now. And so he's taken a bachelor of photographs, but unfortunately he's traveling, so he didn't have time to finish this up, to try to return to us an actual 3D model of this hologram. And the idea then is, once you have that actual 3D model, you can go to different modalities of looking at it. And one thing is, if getting back to the web now, just very simply, this is a very simple 3D model, and what they've done here is most 3D models are constructed of triangles, and what you do is you do what's called texture mapping, where you put in this case it's just solid colors, but what you do is you put the image back onto the triangle that corresponds with that view of that triangle. And so the hope is that we could take this 3D model and texture map our photos back on top of it and actually generate a 3D model. I wish I could have done this with the Lindau Man, but unfortunately we have to do it with this little cartoon character. And another thing is, as Seth alluded to, this is a little cellulose 3D printed car that came from the City Car exhibit that used to be here before the Connections exhibit went in. And this really comes directly from a 3D model. And so why couldn't you take Lindau Man and to first order produce some sort of a three-dimensional view that's a physical object? Let's see, and then there are other tricks that people are developing to sort of provide depth information as you're interacting through the internet. And there's this guy Chris Harrison who's come up with this idea of using a webcam. And what he's done is he's figured out that if you move the webcam around a little bit, you can actually pick up the information that's behind the person's head. And then what he does is he's actually turned on, let's see if I can get this running, face tracking on the camera of the person who's looking at him. And so the webcam knows where her head is and where her eyes are in relationship to the view. And what he can then do is he can turn that into something that gives you the idea of parallax. And so one idea is that if we could provide this 3D model of the hologram, we could actually build something that tracks you through your webcam, and as you move your head around, it could actually let you view this thing through this 3D model. And then, of course, coming back all the way around to the robot, the idea is if you could, in fact, rather than have a canned model, if you could actually put the robot with the camera on it in front of a hologram and deal with the issue of the delay over the internet, you could quite possibly start building a user-controllable webcam so that they could actually explore this hologram on their own. So these are just areas of research that we're working on to try to make this collection a little bit more accessible. So I don't know. Did you have anything else to say? Okay, so I guess we're open for questions.
Okay, thank you. So a few minutes for comments, questions, and then we'll go into the panel discussion. First person I saw was there. I think Seth has the mic, actually. So one of the speakers is now handing out the mic, which is going to cause complications. Maybe we could have the lights back on the stage in a moment.
I could do that.
Oh, he's got to do that. Please. I think Seth. It should be on.
The switch on the bottom. Sideways, slide it. Yeah.
There we are.
Yep.
Craig Neuswanger. It would seem that, like one of the previous talks talking about the work of Hanrahan and light field imaging, and there are some interesting demonstrations of that you can download and actually freely view a rather coarse but interesting light field and move through it. And it would seem that a very structured, as opposed to, say, a robot arm, but a very fixed structure, kind of XY motion, you could capture these things quite readily. They get to be very large data sets, but as far as cataloging and capturing an image, for example, some of the images have kind of time release chemistry in them. For example, a lot of the cylindrical multiplex holograms, people were using mercury based bleaches, I believe, isn't that right?
Mm-hmm.
And those tend to just fade out over time. So it would seem that some of these, if you captured them in this manner, you could really actually ultimately reproduce the hologram later.
Right. Yes. I was actually very excited at the cultural camera talk with the field thing that you guys are working on. And I think in terms of the large data sets, my previous work was in the geographical area, and there's been a lot of work in Google Maps, for instance, the way they manage, or Google Earth, the way they manage feeding you the information as you need it. So it's quite possible that you could do something like that. Aside from the preservation aspect, which I think is great, is also the interactive visualization. Yeah. There's one going over there.
There was somebody here too. I don't want to miss out Brandon.
Yeah.
But yes.
Okay, thank you for the presentation. One, I want to expand on our friend here, that we shouldn't underestimate the 2D displays. There's a huge research going on how to convert 2D to 3D. And with the same talk from the culture camera, on the display side, you would be able to, if you collect your information from different perspectives, which I think you need to only do it once with your robotic arm, it doesn't need to be there all the time, depending on where the observer wants to see from, you can propagate that information to the 2D LCD that they have, and there are different techniques, but you can have lenslet arrays in front of the LCDs, and then you get an autostereoscopic image, meaning that you don't need to have goggles or any special wearing devices, and you would see the 3D perspective from your point of view. The fact is that hologram generate a lot of information.
Right.
That hologram over there, I can see only a portion of that information from this view.
Right.
And the fact is that you can collect that information and selectively present it to the viewer. And that this could be easily done. The technologies out there for 2D, 3D convertible displays. I just wanted to add on that.
Yeah, I think that's true. And thank you for amplifying that.
Please, and then there's a question.
I really appreciate what you're doing with this work, particularly from the point that
Craig made about archival protection of pieces that may fade over time. But I see some other issues here, too. As curator of Rudy Burkhout's work, and I'm very concerned about this issue of getting his work out to the public, because a lot of work of his work hasn't been seen for a long time. And he had started himself on his website to document his work in stereo pairs. And I recently have been looking, you know, I was very interested in going online to your catalog to try and get images for a talk that I was giving on fine art holography, and came to realize that most of your collection isn't up there even in 2D form. So I would first of all say it would be really great if you could get all of the holograms in your collection online. And perhaps the way to start that would be with stereo pairs, because you can shoot those just as easily as shooting a single pair. But another aspect of what I'm starting to do on the practical level is I want to be able to show Rudy's work in more than two dimensions. So there are new technologies out there for shooting, or there are new projectors out there for showing stereo views of video. So I'm actually this month going to be starting to shoot some stereo HD video of his work that I can use as a tool to take around and give people a more visceral experience of his work. But maybe you could be thinking in terms of exploring some of those other lower tech areas, sure, to get this material out there in the meantime.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that the WYSI stuff should preclude some of the I don't know what you might call it, more basic or lower tech approaches, and we should really do them all in some expanding wavefront of our own, as it were. So gathering information about what other people are doing is one of the reasons that we're here. So I think that's great. Do you want to add to that?
Can I add one thing to that? I'm sorry, Seth. I mean, I take very much the point that's being made. Two observations. One is, unfortunately, what is true for our holographic collection, namely that much of it is not available in any meaningful images online, is true for all of the museum's collections. It's only some of our collections that are yet online. And the other point is, the big constraint on that is cost, that every high-quality image capture and uploading onto the web has a unit cost, whatever it is. When you're talking about large numbers, it limits, I'm afraid, the rate at which we do it. And that leads, though, to the point that some of the answer to your question, what do we do first, will not be governed by high principle. It'll be governed by what we can attract funding to do. And I just have a hunch that some of these innovative developments, even if they don't look like the first and most obvious thing to do, may be things that attract funding more easily than the more routine, but ultimately in some ways very much more basic work of just uploading high quality conventional images. So I don't say that to preach pessimism, but just to be a realist, really. I think we probably, going back into my role as chair, we have time for one more question about this, and then we should go into the panel. And Oh, I'm sorry. We've already chosen the person. I can't see them.
Right here.
There,
hi,
please.
Hi, Jody Burns. I have one. I know the museum has many other things in their collection besides the holograms.
For example,
you have catalogs, you have slides, which also have conservation issues, and a lot of old books and documentation and videos and movies about holography that were made early on, and those basically are lost because they're not accessible to anybody. And that's one thing that would be relatively easy, actually, to scan in and document. And I was talking to your director there before that Google, I'm sure all of you know about Google Books. You know, they have a massive program for scanning and everything in the entire world. And they're very open to nonprofit organizations and particularly museums in helping them out. I just finished this great book, Planet Google, which I recommend to everybody here. About their endeavors in that area. And I'm sure if you talk to them, I know that there's an issue with Photosynth being Microsoft, but nevertheless, Google really has a real handle on this stuff, and they could probably help you with it. Thank you.
I mean, these are
great presentation.
Important and obvious work that the museum will do, but I would echo John's statement a bit. to clarify that the reason we undertook or have undertaken this work and are going to continue with it is because of specific funding that we have for pushing the envelope with regard to new technologies and analog holograms. So there's a lot of foundational work to do as you're bringing forward, but it is also true that the museum really needs to build a platform of funding and staff support. It may seem simple or the tools are there to do it, but of course there's time and there's a stretch with regard to the staff members here and what we approach.
That's right, but I want to repeat, we're not pessimistic or fatalistic about this. We want to be realistic, and in fact one message that I was hoping would come out, and it's sort of coming out now, is that MIT's a big place and it looks very well found, as they say, very well endowed from outside. Actually, there's very restricted funding available for the kinds of things that we're talking about in this forum for the MIT Museum right now. And we're very interested in, and we're going to be very proactive about trying to seek funding support for the kinds of initiatives that are being discussed. And I hope very much this community might lend us its support, either directly or indirectly, as our colleague here is, in suggesting ways in which we can do that. Because in the end, the rate-limiting factor for all of this is going to be funding. But in order not for us all to be crying into our proverbial beer, I think we should now move on with thanks.